Amen. Begin to put your hands together all over the table today as we lift up the name of Jesus this morning, as we magnify and glorify God. I said, I'm not praying. Thank you. together all over the building. Knowing that I got right. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord this morning. We got a special treat. We got a special prayer that we want to do. And I feel that needs to come down. Sister Lori, I want you to come up here, Lori, for his glory. Amen. Amen. This is a intercessor. This is a prayer woman. This woman joined the ministry through live stream. from the state of New York. And she's come on with her and her husband, Brother Curtis. They came all the way from New York to be here in person today.
A spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge
just who you are. And in that, Lord God, give them seed for the sower and bread for the eater, Lord God. Help them as they run with the vision that you've given them, Lord God. Provide them with all spiritual, financial, natural, and human resources that they need to do the work that is needed to bring it into fruition. And put a bloodline hedge of protection around them. Dismantle every weapon formed against them. Send consuming fire from heaven to destroy, Lord, every satanic and contrary design against them. Curse the curse at the root, Lord God. Protect them from all wickedness. Thwart every plan, every scheme, every satanic appointment devised against them and the assignment that you've given them. And then, Lord God, we thank you. We thank you for blessing us so generously with pastors according to your heart. We love them, Lord. We love them. And we're grateful for them. Help us to yield to their leadership and obey them and submit to them as they watch for our souls and give account for us so that they may do it with joy and not grief. That it might be profitable to us, Lord. Bless us with increase so that we can generously sow into them the natural things they need as they sow into us the spiritual things that we need, Lord God. And now, Father, appoint your steadfast love and your faithfulness to watch over them. Many lives have been blessed beyond measure for 31 years of pastoral service that they have provided. And we are fully persuaded that many more will be blessed to come. So continue to reveal your glory in them and demonstrate your zeal for them. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
y'all put your hands together one more time all over the building. Thank you, praise God. Choir here, amen. At this time, we want to do. We want to have a couple of people come up and get some testimonials concerning our pastors, amen. We're truly blessed to have such a anointed man and woman of God under our tutelage, amen.
Amen.
And I think back about when I first met Pastor Jeff myself. He actually came to the PCCI. And you actually came, you stood in for someone else who was had to speak. And Pastor spoke about that one thing. That one thing, oh my God. When you say that one thing, we all have that one thing in our life that we need to work on. That one thing that keeps as a thorn in our side. You know, and man, that message really blessed me. It really blessed me. And I was like, me and my wife looked at each other like, who is this guy? and little did we know at that time that as ministry went on and he came up and took over the ministry and then his own ministry, Bethlehem Temple of Praise, was birthed out of that.
Yes.
Out of that ministry and how he's been such a blessing to me and my family. The way that he just teaches the word is so unique and so profound that even a little child can understand it. And really how it really blesses me, sometimes I'll get a text from my 23-year-old. He said, boy, Pastor Jeff preached a powerful message. And he began to talk about the message and so the impact that you've been having on young people.
Yes.
It's just such a blessing, and Pastor Cobb, the enemy is just trying to attack you to stop you from doing what God has called you and has created you to do. And the devil is a lie, and the truth ain't in him. You shall go forth, oh my God, because those two Bible studies are so powerful. They're so powerful, and the way Pastor Cobb comes across, she's just so down to earth, and oh my God, she brings such joy when she speaks the word, when she comes across with the word. You can tell this is a woman, this is a praying woman. You can tell that this is a woman who studies the word. You can tell that this is a man and woman of God who are serious about God and the things of God. And that's the kind of people I want to be with.
Yeah.
And those are the kind of people I'm going to be with. So I thank and praise God for this man and woman of God at this time. Well, a few people to come up and just share their stories and their testimonials and how the man and woman of God has blessed them. Who's going to come forth first? Come on, don't be shy. Go ahead, Sister Sonya, come up and brother.
That's the man.
Oh.
And I said, oh, no, because he
He was pastoring another church in Ohio. I said, no, that's not the man. And there was this gentle voice that says, he's the one. And you are the one. Even when we were on the other person, our church in Benoit, and he came in with this great vision, and we were kind of looking like, okay, this is vision. But he made that come to pass. And then we look at what's taking place now.
Hallelujah!
And you're making that come to pass.
Yes.
This journey has not been easy for you both, but he chose the right one, because your journey has always been a tug of war. That's because you're doing God's work, so you can't say nothing else less.
That's right.
The one thing you can count on is his strength.
Yes.
Yes.
And his faithfulness.
Yes.
And he's trying, the enemy is trying every way to get you there. Health, strength, and your marriage. And I applaud you both for being an awesome example of staying fast. Because we're not going to worry what we just want to keep our eyes and heart focused on the call of what God calls you to do. Thank you. Thank you for being authentic. Thank you for taking the time to listen to what God wants you to say to his people. And I thank you for the journey that you're carrying us on. We're with you. We're with you. So don't doubt, don't fear. We love you. And this celebration, I hope it's a fresh wind to carry you to that next level, that sail, that wind that you need to propel you to where God wants to carry you. So it's an honor to sit under your leadership and look forward to what God has in store for you in the future.
Worshiping you, praising you, your wife, and this congregation. So with that, like you said, I started back writing.
All right.
And this poem is called Bethlehem Temple of Praise. Here we stand not alone, for our Heavenly Father has blessed B-Top with this beautiful home. For Pastor Jeff and Pastor Carr to bless and praise the citizens of this community with joy, love, and peace.
Yes.
Thanking Jesus Christ. One moment. Thanking Jesus Christ for his unconditional will and promises as we greet, as members to come and worship in this beautiful B-Top home and come grounded on their feet. We are blessed with grace and mercy, thanking God as he sits on the throne to learn about the Holy Spirit, body and soul. As the ministry begins to unfold, we are covered by the blood. Matthew 26, verse 26-28. For someone may enter into these pearly gates. For we know this has been a journey for us, all supporting Pastor Jeff and Pastor Carl through it all as a minister for others to be called. Romans 8, verse 28. Here you will learn how to tune up your spiritual ears as we shed our spiritual tears, bringing help, healing, and wholeness through the love of Jesus Christ. For God, Jesus, Jehovah, Yahweh, has always paid the price. Thank you.
Now, I'm not much of a speaker, but in the 3.5 years that I've been under Pastor Jeff and Pastor Carl's leadership, God has given me 2 songs, both leading right up to the pastoral anniversary. So if I can share that song with you guys today, is that alright? I know your time, I see your tears, it feels like you're walking in circles, and nothing's gone your way in years. So look to the light.
Yeah.
in you to do for me. Now that you're broken, he says there's a lot left in you to do for me. Now that you're broken, so how could you use me when you know this and that about me? Oh, there's a lot.
Yes, God.
He's a servant of God, a husband and father, leader, preacher, teacher, musician, and a recording artist. Amen. He's a St. Louis native, born first twins to his parents, Timothy Price Jr. and Virginia Price. He's the oldest of four children. Dr. Price is the husband of Lady Callie Price, and they share five children together. From a young age, Dr. Price has always carried a torch for declaring the Word of God. As a licensed and ordained elder in the Lord's Church for over 30 years, he has served in the position of senior pastor, worship pastor, director of fine arts, minister of music, evangelist, workshop clinician, conference speaker, instructor, musician, and administrator. Amen. God has graced him to call various music genre and travel extensively around the United States and internationally in such places such as Japan, London, and the Bahamas. He is a Stellar-nominated songwriter and artist who has penned songs for many gospel artists and has recorded music all over the world. Dr. Price is an accomplished author of five self-published books. His latest release, Assessing Cultural Influences in Worship, was published in January of 2021. This was his doctoral dissertation project where focus on cultivating an inclusive worship gathering of multi-generations and cultures in the life of the church. Amen. Dr. Price is a high school graduate from the Central Visual and Performing Arts of St. Louis, Missouri. His education continued at the Liberty University, Lynchburg, Virginia, where he earned a Bachelor of Science in Religious Studies with a concentration in worship. He also earned a Master of Arts in Worship Studies and Leadership, amen, from Liberty University School of Music. Reverend Timothy completed his educational journey with a doctoral ministry from the South University, Savannah, Georgia. As his journey continues, he currently serves as a licensed funeral director at the historic Austin A. Lane Mortuary. He is an associate minister of Christ Southern Mission Baptist Church
under the covering of Pastor Jeffrey Ron, his increasing passion to touch lives through the Word of God, his testimony of God's grace, and his desire to creatively bring individuals back to the heart of God has opened the door for him to the 20th elected senior pastor of the historic First Baptist Church of St. Louis, Missouri. Ladies and gentlemen, I bring to you Dr. Timothy D. Price III. Come on, man of God. Have your way.
This is what I want you to preach months ago. And
And the more I listen to them, and even the more I've been in here, some of y'all already preached my message, but the Lord said, this is what I want you to do, and I want you to preach. So we're going to do what the Lord has told us to do. Amen. And it's better to be obedient.
Yes,
amen. In the Spirit of the Lord. And we thank God for what He is doing. Amen. I'm in this weird space now, Pastor Jeff. You know, I used to be like that young man that was up here singing soprano. There it is. Keep singing, young man. Amen. And I used to sing high and low and all those wonderful things. I could sing high, but that's the more I preach, my voice is starting to change. And the older I get, my voice is starting to change. I can't sing like Sam or Shantae. I can't do this. And Shantae is making me more and more nervous back there behind me. Doing all these runs and all these things. And then Pastor Jeff is next to me doing all these runs. And I'm like, Lord, help me. I can't go in here and just sing anything because they're going to make me nervous and look at me like, well, this man is supposed to be a recording on this, all these things. And he can't be. So, you got to understand what I'm saying. So, I'm going to preach. Amen. But won't you stand to your feet for a few moments as we get ready to go to the Word of God? What can you do in that?
I'm an A flat.
You're A flat? You're a B flat. I was just going to do something. I'm a little church boy. All I know is church. And I'm a good house and preacher, but I got a lot of Baptist proclivities. I love the Lord. And but I am, because in this space, which was celebrating the anniversary, I realized that we would not be here if they never told the Lord yes. And so I don't know about you, but aren't you glad that they told the Lord yes? But oftentimes, Pastor Gene, when you tell the Lord yes, it does not come with a lot of wonderful things. We challenge you, we hard, and you find yourself where you be broken. And a lot of things come with that, but you know, hold on to a yes. Because when you say yes, there's a yes in heaven also. That will come down, solidify what you've done. Oftentimes when we have been called by purpose, the Greek word for purpose is telos. And what telos really is, if I take it into the away from the Greek translation of it and bring it to what we understand, telos, when I subtract something from it, it means to take. When you're walking in purpose, your purpose tells who you are. In other words, you can't just do what everybody do. You can't go where everybody go. You can't hang with everybody. I find myself, I know a lot of people, but I'm a very lonely person. Because I can't do what everybody else do. And enough, I want to protect my anointing and the purpose that's on my life. You cannot be around and hang out with everybody. So we thank God for their yes. Yes. Would you help me sing it? Yes. Come on, let's switch on. Yes. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I don't mean to start my trouble too disturbing, but grab someone by the hand and say, I don't know what you've been through. Something feels like that.
Nor height, nor depth,
nor any other shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Before you take your seat, tell your neighbor, I have to fight for this. The book of Romans has been referred to as the constitution of Christianity. The theologians and scholars have examined and considered it as the manifesto and cathedral of our faith. Romans was written by the Apostle Paul during his third missionary journey in Corinth. When he wrote it, he had three objectives. The first one was to teach the fundamental doctrine of salvation. And the second was to explain the unbelief of Israel and to vindicate the faithfulness of God concerning Israel. And then the third thing was to give practical instructions concerning Christian living in the society of that day. The epistle was not an exclusive message to the Roman church in Corinth. However, it was an inclusive message to all believers of faith. And in our present pericope, we find what can be theologically examined as the fourth installment of this epistle, which dealt with the dichotomy of two very familiar realities of life. They are suffering and victory. See what we say, suffering and victory. In his writing, he could have given only one side to a Christian's life, the side that most church folk only like to disclose, and most people even on social media like to share. The side when everything is all good. However, if you read through the writings of Paul, he was one of those preachers that just kept it real. He showed us that a life with Christ has been victories, but it also includes some suffering. Thank you, Lord. Sufferings that are not only self-inflicted, but are situationally inflicted, demonically inflicted, and even people inflicted. And I'm sure you're familiar with those things. There are sufferings of insecurity, sufferings of divorce, sufferings of disappointment, sufferings of challenges with your children. Now, I'll get to your street in a minute. Sufferings of job loss, anointed but still broken, serving but still angry, praising God but you still broke. Who am I talking to you? Suffering. Some of us can look at our lives and can sing the testimony, I've had some good days. I had some heels to climb. There have been times when we have had little or no security in areas where we have craved the most. Have experienced rejection from those who were closest to us. Oh God. Now you are skeptical and look at people's side eye because you have been hurt so many times. Hurt by people you trusted. Hurt by people you believed in. Hurt by people that walked close to you. And you felt like you were damaged and could never heal. There are things that no one knows that you've been through. Some of you, it was a struggle just to get out of bed this morning. and put some clothes on and comb your hair if you got it. Brush your teeth so that you can put on a fake smile and walk in church and raise your hands. And so when someone pops you and you feel like you got all these things that are weighing you down, but why are you silently suffering and going through challenges and the vicissitudes of life, but you're still here? You're in the house of worship this morning. You pressed your way and you didn't give up. You realized quitting was not an option, Pastor, because the Lord has kept you. He held you together. You didn't lose your mind. He sustained you for a reason. He didn't let you go down in the midst of it. Who am I talking to? You have to fight your way through the sufferings of this life. And I came this morning to tell somebody, I don't know who this is for, but your suffering days are over. Oh, man, you just missed your shot right there. That is a prophetic word. You got to teach it right there in the Holy Ghost. And I just told you, your suffering days are over. You want to mess up with your hands and say, thank you, Lord. Better days are ahead. I hear you, Peter. Peter said it like this. He said, after you have suffered a lot, don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. I had to suffer, but I kept showing up. I even served while I was in pain. I kept being there. I danced even though it hurt me. I smiled even though my pain was before me. Can we go a little bit deeper here? What is a fight?
Tell us.
I'm glad you asked. A fight is a violent struggle or some form of confrontation with an opposing force or an individual. But the thing I've learned about fights, because I was never one that fight, I had a whole lot of mouth, but I ain't had a fight. The thing about fight, it has two sides to it. There is a winner, and then there is a loser. When there is a fight, one defends themselves with the intention to destroy, to defeat, or subdue their adversary. Fights are always evenly matched. And not everyone who's fighting has a fighting chance. Okay, what do you mean, Dr. Price? Okay, come here, David. David said it like this. He said, David was short, he was rooted, he was a nice little guy, but he was small. He went to war against Goliath, a giant. And then his people tried to arm him with weapons that did not fit him. But he came out victorious. Look back over what you had to face. I'm talking to you now. Look back all the struggles you had to endure. And not everyone was able to endure some of the stuff that you've been through. Lord, help me here. And not every fight that you had to go through was evenly matched. Lord, help me, Jesus. Every time I say however, I get excited. However, the Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The Bible says that no weapon formed against you will be able to prosper. But I had to fight. I had to fight. I had to fight. Tell somebody, say, I had to fight. I'm sure there were some things in 31 years of pastoring, and even in this church, some battles that you didn't see coming.
coming, but you had to fight. There are some things that some of you all sitting in here that you ain't told nobody about, that you had to fight for. Oh, God. There are some obstacles that you didn't see coming. There are some challenges that you didn't see yourself having to endure and have to face. I'm coming to your street already. There are some stuff you didn't see that was going to happen. You didn't know you were going to have to deal with that. But listen, Paul said he's out of seven times, Lord, to remove this stone from me, but God lets you keep it.
Because somebody needs to see the suffering that you're going through.
Yeah. Not that you're going through and you're going down, but the fact that you came out of it. That's what God wants to do. Sometimes God lets you go through suffering. So you tell somebody how you overcame it. As a matter of fact, grab somebody by the hand and say, you don't have to know what I went through. Just know I came out of it.
This is your anniversary, but I might need your organ for a
second.
I feel something pushing me.
So
the first thing he does here, Paul tells us, is that, and I came to tell you this morning, is that you got help.
All right.
Tell somebody, say, I got help. Paul shows us that there will be obstacles in life, Lord Jesus. And I can imagine that in 31 years of pastoring that there have been a few fights. A few obstacles. A few struggles. And fighting, you find yourself as a pastor, and I'm saying this, you find yourself fighting against criticism. Conflict,
yes.
Trying to get people to understand your vision.
Come on, sir.
And then there were some fights that are inherited that you should not have gotten.
Yes.
But God knew that you could handle it.
Yes.
Fights, stress over ministry, stress over budgets, fighting against burnout and wanting to give up. Fighting, trying to find time for your family and for yourself. Fighting, trying to find financial challenges. Dealing with time management. Dealing with issues with members. There's a multicultural church in here, so some things I'm just not going to say.
Y'all
understand.
No pastor or leader is exempt from these potential enemies. And Paul said it this way. These enemies desire to kill us in cold blood because they hate us. They want to sift us like wheat. Push pause. When sifting wheat, the grain has to be beat down. It has to be grounded up. It has to be pulverized between stones and sharp teeth. That may feel like some of y'all, what y'all been going through. You feel like that you've been beat down. You've been grounded and pulverized between stones and sharp teeth. Push button. When Paul used this illustration, he was simply saying that they are sin ducks.
Yeah.
That's a bad place to be in. You mean to tell me that God called me to pastor and you telling me that I'm a sin duck because I tell him yes? You mean to tell me that I'm walking, I'm doing the best I can to live a life that's consecrated, that pleases the Lord, but he all comes back and tells me that I am a sitting duck because I believe God and have faith in God?
But the Bible says the enemy desires to pick us off one by one, church by church, member by member, family by family, pastor by pastor. If you look at what the pandemic did, it shut down a lot of churches. A lot of pastors gave up. But you have to thank God for a quick ball that has stayed in. Because not only did it bring you to this place, but now B-Top is a one church in two locations.
All right, come on now.
Some people look at what we do and think that it's glamorous, but they really do not know the enemies that we have to face. That's why Paul had to keep it real with us in this text. And at the same time, he made sure that we had a clear understanding that God is greater than any enemy coming after us. Because he is greater. Somebody say, he is greater.
He is greater.
And what looks overwhelming to us is nothing to God. It was significantly greater. I know it took you down. I know it held you down. But God is greater. I know you felt alone, but you got help. Yeah. Let me get some back. Hear it, Paul. Paul says in Romans 8:28, he says, and we know.
Right.
Let me say it again. He says, and we know.
Yes, sir.
See, y'all said it again. Some of y'all need to get an and anointing. So when the devil brings stuff up to you, just look at him and say, and. You can't say amen because you don't know. But when you know, you can look back there and say amen. So when the doctor gives you a bad report, you look back at the doctor and say amen. When the devil tells you that people are talking bad about you, amen. Push pause. Now sometimes when people are talking bad about me, somebody brings that to me, I say, and what did you say? Sorry, that was for me. Excuse me. I didn't really know that. That was for me. That was for me. That helps you watch who you're hanging around with. Because my friends don't let people talk bad about me.
All right.
My members don't let people talk bad about my pastor. And if somebody brings a mess to me about my pastor, I'm going to look at them and say, and who do you think you're talking to?
All right, excuse me. I didn't mean that was, sorry, that was, I'm trying to help you out. That was really for me too.
But the Bible says, and we know that all things work together. As a matter of fact, because I really want you to get this, I want the next time the devil puts something in your face, just look back at the devil and say,
amen.
We know that all things are working together for the good of them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. And what shall we say to these if God be for us? No.
Yes, sir.
No, we see that they're trying to come and get us and try to mess us up. If God be for us. I know what the politicians here began and can't do. But if God be for us. I know every obstacle that you have to face. Look at somebody say, if God be for us, I got help.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
I got help. It makes you feel more confident. When you're going into a fight, you don't walk in there because, you know, because that was how I was. I had a whole lot of mouth and I was going to say whatever I wanted to say. But I can do that because I had help.
Yeah.
I was never by myself. So when I now, sometimes when I walk into situations and I know it's not meant to work out in my favor, Pastor, what I do now because I know that God is with me, I walk in still confident. Because I got help. I ain't going down because I know who got my back. The Bible says he will go before us and be our, also be our rear guard. I got help.
Yeah.
We told the test and I said, I got help.
I got help.
Mm-hmm. Let me
keep going.
I know you had the point of disaster and it seemed like everything was falling apart. Sent me here to give you confirmation by this prophetic word. I want you to receive this. When things seemed like they were falling apart, all they were doing was falling right into place.
I said,
when things were seeming like they was falling apart, right into place.
You just missed your shot. Let me say it one time. Maybe they like it if I say this.
I said when things seemed like they were falling apart, God told me to tell you it's really falling right into place. If I got a witness out there, just lift your hand and say, yes, it is.
The Bible says, I'm almost at E-flat. Let me hear E-flat first. The Bible says in verse 29 and 30. Thank you. All right, that's me. In verses 29 and 30. It says, well, who did he for me? He also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. I'm still in the text. That he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. And whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. Paul said this. He said, there will be challenges for those who love God. But God, who is omniscient, which means he's all-knowing, has the inside scoop about your situation. I wish somebody here like me believe that as well. And so I came to tell you this morning, Pastor C, that it was a setup. Because he already fought him. Lord, help me, Jesus. He knew how the story was going to end. Can I just tell you here, let's take a pause and take a personal statement and a personal testimony to let you know that when it looks like the book is closed, you don't have to close the book. All God is doing is just creating another chapter inside the book. You told me, grab somebody by the hand. I said, what God does,
This is what he does.
He will complete something, and then he'll go back and start. So he always has a reference point of how it's going to end. He completes it before he starts. So before 31 years, he was gonna get this point.
Yes,
he already completed it before he started.
All
right. But this is the thing. Sometimes when we're going through the process of it, don't look like we're ever gonna get to the finish line. But Lord, help me, Holy Ghost. He said nothing was happening that he had already known about. God said it was a setup. You've been frustrated. You've been trained, but God for you. The word for you means that you have more than just an advanced knowledge of something. Foreknowledge is when God has determined the outcome, even though the process seemed chaotic. That's why you cannot identify yourself by the process. You have to identify yourself by the promise that God has made to you. I know He spoke to me. I know He said to me. And I know the process may seem chaotic. But come here, watch this. He not only forming, He also predestined it. Now predestined means, I'm almost there. Predestined means that God always solidified your destiny. And
agreements, and he knew how he was going to carry out when he started it. And then he settled how it was going to end. Oh, can I preach how I feel it? I feel like preaching right now. I came all the way from St. Louis to give you a word before I even knew anything about this church. The Lord said, don't give up. Reach over and grab somebody by the hand and say, don't give up. Preach how I feel it. I'm about to know, God. I'm about to give you your second wind. But I told you to tell you, don't give up. I know you've been praying, but don't give up. I know it was challenging, but don't give up. I'm about to give you your strength back. I'm about to redeem the time that you have lost. Don't give up. I'm going to give you your energy back. Don't give up. But don't give up. It was really falling right into place. I know it seemed hard. I know it didn't seem like it was going to make it. But this is what God does. He gives you a peek at how it's going to end. So you can get your second wind. And I came to tell you this morning that God has given you a peek into how it's going to end. What God is going to do here at B-Top. He said, eyes have not seen, nor ears have heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of men. What God is going to do here at B-Top. And when you say, well, Pastor, I got a whole lot of stuff that has nothing to do with B-Top, but I came to tell somebody this morning. What's coming is better than what's been. I know it seems hard. I know it seems difficult. But I've got to tell you this morning that God's got something good and sure for you. God's got something good on your way. I know it seems like you've been fighting for the whole time. God, I told me to tell you.
And a heavy load. He's got your back. You Shoot!
Lord just changed my message. If I preach this again, then I'm going to check, I'm going to call it shift change. Tell somebody shift change. Some of y'all been creeping up in the third shift, but can't nobody see you. You've been working and suffering on the third shift. But God said, I'm moving you from the third shift to the first shift. Because some people need to see what God brought you out of. You've been hiding, but now it's time for everybody to see what the Lord has done. Oh God, your weeping days are over, my brother. Your crying days are over, my sister. I know you've been praying for your son, your grandson, your nephew. Somebody here praying for their nephew right now. But God told me to tell you shit change.
Hallelujah.
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 He
like touching somebody right here. But I want you to just grab somebody by the hand and tell God to shame you for it.
Hallelujah.
You see, the power ain't in me touching you. The power's in your faith. It's in the agreement that you heard with the Lord before, that God is changing it for you. So, Pastor, this is what, when I was on the plane, I tell y'all this, and I asked the Lord, what is this about? So when I was on the plane heading here, I dealt with a little bit of, they call it tennis elbow. And I'm a man of a particular age, like this. And so sometimes when I have pains, you know, I just don't bounce back real quick from those things. I'm closing it real. But as I was on my way here, I started to get this really increased pain in my own. And it was so painful. I felt like, man, stop this fight, because it almost felt like my arm was about to explode. That's how painful it was. So I asked my pastor, I said this. He said, well, okay. Brought me here for a reason. And this pain is not going to stop me from doing what you assigned me to do. But immediately, as I was talking, the Holy Spirit said, shh. The pain you're experiencing has nothing to do with you. It is a sign that there was somebody in this church. Is experiencing some uncomfortable pain in their body. And somebody's about to be healed.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! I don't know who this is, y'all. Excuse me, I'll step out the live stream.
Yes,
I don't know who this is for. But somebody in here has been dealing with some serious pain. And that increased pain that I had in my arm was just a reflection of the pain that somebody's been dealing with. But God told me to tell you, he's about to heal. I can pass this anymore. Be careful about touching women. So I'm careful. God told me to tell you, I want you to lay hands on this woman. And God is going to heal. And I'm going to absolutely every part of me that's been hurting. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for complete healing in the name of Jesus. And the wind of God opens within. And the healing of God. Healing is the children's bread. God said he's healing right there. He's opening up the circulation in your blood vessels. In the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you that the pain is gone. I thank you that healing is heard as well. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. There's somebody else in here. My eye is just right now. There's somebody back here. I don't know who it is. There's somebody back here, you've been hiding. There's somebody back here, you've been hiding. I want you to meet me here today. That's what says, I felt it over. That somebody, you've been hiding and you have not been telling anybody about what you've been going through.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh, boy.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Lift your hands over God. Lift your hands. And so that you know this, the sickness that you have is not unto death. you're facing in your body. It seems to keep you and hold you hostage, debilitate you. And sometimes you feel like that you're limited by what you can do. But I believe that the Lord is, first of all, he's going to heal your mind. That's the first thing he's going to do. He's healing your mind as I'm speaking. He's giving you peace in your mind. The Bible says our faith. God will use our faith to help us, but he'll use the issues that challenge us in our faith to strengthen us. And I know somebody has hurt you. You've been hurt. You've been wounded. And sometimes it's difficult to believe what people are saying to you because you can't believe it for yourself. But God said, just believe it for yourself when you're alive. And watch the healing come. Healing is right there at your door. And let me thank you, Holy Spirit. Healing is at the door. But God said all you have to do is go up under the mat and get the key and open up the door. But the problem is you can stand at the door and you refuse to go up under the mat and get the key. The key is believe it.
Yes.
He's healing your mind. He's healing you right now in your body. Father, I thank you for my sister. Lord, to your name. That whatever it is she's dealing with, God, I know that you're able to heal it. God, whatever I pray that you heal it in her mind, heal her heart, give her strength, God, give her a second wind, and now change the narrative, God, in the name of Jesus. And God, I believe it. Who's important when you believe what it broke out? In the name of Jesus. And we lift you up and we magnify it. Now I want you to go to strength, walk in power. I want you to believe it. I want you to put a smile on me. Keep smiling. Come on, throw that smile. Yeah, you can smile. Come on, come on. And I believe that God is going to change it. Come on, change it. Walk with it. Let's walk with it.
Right back. He said, I have to
say it. How much longer do I have to wait? The wait is over.
Neighborhood that the Lord is going to give you favor with.
I don't know what you've been praying for, man, God, over that. I don't know what you've been asking, God. I don't really know what he's been talking, what they've been releasing to you all in vision. But there is something else in this neighborhood. And I'm talking, does that make sense? There's something else in this neighborhood. You thought it began with this. But this is just the beginning. This is not the end of it. God brought you into this community. I see a house, a transitional house. Being changed because of B-Time.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
And I see people not just being, we talked about this, not just being consumers of the church, but now they become disciples and servants in the church. But people are going to come back and they're going to say, well, how can I help you all in this?
Yes.
Well, that house, they owe taxes on it. You just pay the taxes, you can have it.
Wow.
I'm just saying, this is what the type of stuff that the Lord does.
Yes,
Lord. Let me close with this. This is my testimony. I've been in, I pastor the oldest church this side of the Mississippi River. The church is 206 years old.
Wow.
The building we're in is over 80 years old. The church, I am the 20th pastor of this 206-year-old church. Everything about the church is antiquated. It's not pleasing to people to want to come to the church. That's cool. I'm all right. And it's in the hood. That's even better. I ain't from the hood, but I grew up in the hood. And I understand the hood. And I ain't scared of nobody. So, in our church, I prayed in August. I put the church on a whole month of prayer. And one of the things that we asked the Lord for was for unlimited resources. And I'm saying this because this is how I want you to pray with us about this. We ask the Lord for unlimited resources. Now, I walked away from a job. I was the music administrator, a very large church, making a good salary. But the Lord told me to accept this position as the pastor. A third of my income, that's gone. I haven't received it back. The Lord makes away every month. I don't know how he does it.
All right.
What I get as salary as a pastor is not even half what I was getting as a music minister. That was
okay.
It's cool. I ain't going to come up. But I pray and ask the Lord for unlimited resources, not just for me to have a good salary, but also for me to do some things in the church that we could not afford to do.
All right.
Because when you have a church that old, it comes with a lot of old problems, a lot of issues in the building. So, a few weeks after we completed our time of prayer, someone sent me an email and said, have you heard about this grant? They closed it in August, but they opened it back up. And it's closing on October 30th. Now you may want to look into this grant. Now this grant is for $37 million. And they have to award it out by December 24th this year. That's okay, all right, cool, let me look into it. I went to my team and I asked them, I said, they have these different requirements. Do we have any of these things? You know, simple stuff, people think the church should have 501c3, all these other things, but nobody responded. I said, we need to have a meeting. do we have all of these things?
Well, Pastor, we're working on this, and no, I didn't ask what you're working on. What do we not have? Well, this is 3 weeks ago. Well, Pastor, we don't seem to have any of these things that they're asking for. So I sat down, I said, okay, all right. That Lord, I've been praying to you for unlimited resources. And I've been asking for certain things. So that the Lord, 2 days after that, I prayed the Lord send somebody, 2 people called me. And said, how did you call this accountant that helped you get some things that you need to put structurally in place for the church? I said, okay. I didn't have an accountant's number, but I had a husband's number because he's a pastor. I said, Bishop, I need permission to talk to your wife. He gave me permission to talk to the accountant. And then after that, someone called me and said, you didn't call this young lady. She's a grant writer. I said, okay, I called her. Brought them both together. And I told them we have 3 weeks to apply for this grant. Now, some of you all who are a little bit more intelligent than I am about certain things, nonprofits and all those different things, you can't get EINs and 501c3s and all those other things in a matter of 3 weeks. And then my church, I'm sorry, I hope none of my members are here watching. Tell all my business, but I haven't filed taxes in a long time. Even though we're tax exempt, we still have to file. So that meant we had to go back a long way to get our taxes in order and get them filed in time, which is one of the requirements for the grant. So now we're working sun up and sun down, trying to make this thing happen. Had to have contractors come in and get bids on things because I'm trying to replace and rehab the entire building inside, outside, do a new parking lot. And then we used to have a community center, and the community center got torn down because they couldn't afford to take care of it. I want to rebuild a brand new community center. I said, if you shoot for the moment, this would be getting solved. So we finished up the grants and finished up a lot of stuff that was able to do. I had a little friend that was somebody I knew with us in the mayor's office, and called him and said, we got everything, but they said, just get the stuff in and then put an addendum in there that you're working on this. Cool. So we did everything we could and put the addendum in there, got the grant, and we requested $7 million on the grant. We got it in on October 30th at 5 o'clock. We got everything in at 3 o'clock on October 30th. But wait a minute. When we got there, because I emailed them, I want to make sure they had it. I emailed them to them, and then I had my chairman, I think it will go in another hand delivered as well. I ain't got no problems. I want to make sure they can get this stuff. When we get there, at 3 o'clock, the chairman wasn't passing. We got a problem. I said, what's the problem? He said, there's a couple things that we don't have, but they said they got to have this in order to submit it and put it on the desk. I said, okay, so what's the problem? What we need? Immediately, I got it on the computer. I did one thing. It's on samsung.gov and had to get our unique identity. Got that done. That was real quick. All right, cool. That's done. Then I said, go downstairs to the city clerk office and do this. It's okay, Pastor, I'm running. And he went and did something, but he couldn't get it. It created a problem. So he had to run home and get something else and do this. By the time, make the long story short, by 4:35, something like that, he walks in the office and gives them the stuff. And someone said, they said, well, where y'all stuff it? He said, well, I gave it to this young lady. She said she's going to hold on to it until we get this other stuff. She said, don't worry about it. He said, give me what you got. And she took it right straight to the person's desk, who has to sign off on the grants. Uh-huh. Now, we have a $7 million grant that we're asking for to rehab
an 800 seat auditorium. Inside, outside, put the elevator and some other things. The church is 206 years old, and I want to put a museum in the church because it has a lot of rich history and everything like that, of that nature. And y'all have to come down and see it when it gets done. I'm telling you, it's going to get done. But I say this to say this because I want y'all to pray with me, but I also, God puts people in your path for a certain reason. And He connects you for a certain reason. I believe that there are some uncharted waters that you all want to know about. And I want you to begin to start investigating. There were some grants, and there were some things that this community has that I want you to begin to start looking for. Some of y'all that already know how to do that kind of stuff. See, what the Lord is going to do in this season for this church has nothing to do with what you have in the bank account. It's going to create, you need more than what's inside the bank. Do you know what I'm saying, church? And I'm saying this because I feel I've been speaking this authority because my pastor has already dealt with this. That God will give unlimited resources, but it's going to take you have to trust Him first and then begin to start doing the work to see where they are. The Bible says there are hidden riches in secret places. That's the word of the Lord. There are hidden riches in secret places. And I'm speaking over this church right now in the name of Jesus that God is getting ready to release hidden riches in secret places. That means partnerships. That means grants. That means untouched money that people are not messing with. But God is about to put it in your hands. Now you are receiving the word from the Lord right now. He did it because He knows He can trust you with it. He allowed you to go through these things because He had to test your faith to see where it was at. But because you were faithful, you stayed the course and you pushed through. God said He's going to give it to you. If you believe, come on, clap your hands.
Get it in this room, get it in this room.
got Lizard Way to get to. Got Cash App. I want us to do that this week. Which one's your pastor? Purpose of a pastor. So do this one. How would you place that gift in your right hand? Place that gift, whatever it is you want to give. And I promise we'll leave this song short and long. I want you to say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Say it one more time, real loud, like you mean. Say,
the Lord is
my shepherd.
I lack nothing.
Father, we thank you for every gift that you have wanted, that are given today. Father, I ask that you give it back to me a hundredfold. Let it be a blessing to these pastors and to the building of this church. And we lift up your holy name and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I don't know if there's certain one of y'all, there's nothing where you are. There's nothing where you are. There's nothing where you are. What's going on? Is there certain where you are? You have?
Amen. Philippians 4:19, Luke 6:38, amen. So I think you want to come around from the
Close our eyes, just walk around. Whatever the gift is, you're gonna get. Let's give to the man of God this time. This is an obedience, amen.
Before we do the benediction.
as we prepare to receive our senior pastor at this time.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
I said glory to God.
Hallelujah.
I want to be obedient to the Lord. As Dr. Price was preaching, the Lord gave me a passage of scripture for him, and it's found in Mark chapter 10, beginning with verse 29. And this is what it says. So Jesus answered and said, "Assuredly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's who shall not receive 100-fold now in this time with persecutions and in the age to come eternal life." Amen. Mark chapter 10, beginning at verse 29. Amen. Amen. I want to thank the anniversary committee. Everybody in the anniversary committee, on the anniversary committee, would you please stand? Would you please stand? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And the chairman of the anniversary committee, thank you. This really represents the Lord. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much. We have a couple of things to do, and we're going to be brief because we're normally out of church at this time and at the restaurant, but we knew it would be a little bit longer today. Amen.
Yes.
Why y'all so quiet? We stay in church all day, come back for 3:30 service. Well, I did. Sunday school, 11 o'clock, 3:30, 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
And then go out to Denny's after 6 o'clock service. Amen. Amen. What we want to do, God is moving in our midst. That was a good place to say amen. I said, God is moving in our midst, and we want to do this first, and then we're going to recognize a few people. We have among us a very gifted, and she's not even in here. Will somebody go? Yes, would you? I don't know why she's not in here. But we have amongst us a very gifted, very educated person in the person of our own Reverend Glory Whitmore. Along with Sister Joy and Brother Tony. Here she is. Here she is. She has been added to the pastoral team and elevated to the pastoral team of Bethlehem Temple of Praise. And so today, we present you with this certificate, Pastor Lori Whitmore, in the elevation to pastoral ministry, Bethlehem Temple of Praise, November 5th, 2023. Amen. You can do better than that. Amen. Glory to God. So she will have many assignments. We've already discussed them. And we will address her as Pastor Lori. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Not Sister Lori. Amen. Amen. And we will experience even more that God has for her to do. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. I normally do not live by this premise. It's better to ask for forgiveness than it is to ask for permission.
we don't live under this premise that it's better. Have you all ever heard that statement? It's better to ask for forgiveness than permission. Amen. But with this particular person, I know we're going to get in trouble, but we must honor a gift, a jewel among us. She works behind the scenes, and she's probably going to shoot me if she brought her pistol to church today. But we're going to recognize none other than Sister Elaine Michette. Don't kill me. Please don't kill me now.
Hallelujah. There are others. Now let me say.
She said she's gonna shoot both of them. Let me say that there have been people. I can't honor everybody. The committee first told me no, I could not honor anybody, and I sent the person back to the committee because I don't take no for an answer. Amen. There are persons who helped keep everything together during the pandemic. And I want to honor me, Pastor and I, and the church, want to honor this person. Please be in prayer for her. She lost her older brother yesterday to a house fire in Mississippi. Wow. None other than Sister Lucille Curry. Come on up. Come on up. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you for all that you do. Our next person, they tell me hurry up. Our next person, these people, when I went to them and asked them to coordinate and be team leaders, they did that. Our next person is a faithful person. I asked her, I need you to coordinate and take over the diaconate ministry for me, and she said I will do so, and that's none other than our own sister Sonya Castleman. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The next person is just a wonderful, wonderful gift to the body of Christ, to be taught. He's an all-around guy. Anything he finds his hands to do, he does that. And we would be remiss if we did not recognize our own Pastor David Hughley. Thank you. The next person came, he said earlier, he came 3 years ago. I actually thought it was longer than that. He came and he fell right in, began to serve, and we want to praise God for none other than our own brother Sam Herbert. The next person, we all know and love her, and we want to appreciate her. She's been through a lot, but God has brought her through, and that's our own psalmist, Sister Shantae Scott. Thank you. Thank you for all that you do. Just a little something. And then, last but not least, the youngest son in our clan, who is faithful every Sunday on those drums, and that's none other than our youngest son, Caleb Ashton Richardson. Crazy. Okay, he disappeared, but this honor is for him. And then I want to thank my husband so much for all he does for our family. and I'm not going to take a long time because I can't, as they used to say at my church, you can't tell it all. I cannot tell it all. But I want to thank him publicly and honor him publicly for everything he does for our family and for our church family. And I wish a few folks would join me in thanking him and praising God for our pastor, our senior pastor, Pastor Jeff Richardson. Thank you, D-Top. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you all for everything you've done. And if I did not call your name, please forgive me, but we could not do this without you all. I said we couldn't do it without you all. We need everybody participating and everybody putting in and carrying the load. Thank you for those that came, for the guests, for those that came all the way from New York, our members, amen. And we give glory to God for all of you. God bless you.
Thank you, Dr. Price, for blessing us the way you did today. This is more of our convention family, and this was our first time reaching out to convention family to ask them to come and be a part. Thank you. You left your pulpit to come worship with us today, and I don't take that lightly.
You need to do what I told you. I told you that this church has a pastor.
We usually have two services on this day, a morning and an afternoon, but sometimes that's strange, so people are not used to that anymore. So this service, for those that are visiting with us today, this is not our norm, believe me. We have several Holy Ghost timekeepers that give me certain signals to make sure that we're out by 12:30 or so. But thank you for hanging in with us today, because there's no afternoon service, and the committee decided to do everything on Sunday morning so that we can get a good concentration of people without worrying about having to come back for the afternoon. And I want to tell you how much I appreciate that. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It is so great to see D-Top here. I know that many of you catch up on Sunday on the live stream, or you catch it later during the week, but today you made the sacrifice to come on out. And I know it's a sacrifice after, you know, being at home and being able to watch in the comfort of whatever you have on, in whatever room you want to be in, sipping on coffee or eating a Danish, but to get up, get your clothes on, and come out, thank you. Pastor Carmen and I thank you. We thank you for walking with us in this journey of faith. Everybody can't take a walk like this. But I thank you all for being the kind of people that you are. We've honored some of those that have been just stars through this whole period and keeping things together. All of us together make this happen. Whatever you give and whatever you contribute, we thank you from the bottom of our hearts. We never got into ministry for money or fame or fortune or any kind of accolades. We just said yes, not knowing what we would encounter along the way. But God gave us the grace and God gave us the gifting to do exactly what we're doing. And I'm looking forward to everything that is to come. Oh, we've got a bright future, and I thank God for a second wind. I didn't say that because I was getting ready to preach. I'm just letting you know that I'm still excited about what God is doing. Pastor, thank you so much. Come on up and you can dismiss us. Thank you again for everything that you have done to make this appreciation season what it is. I really, really appreciate you. We're in it for the long haul. And I thank God for your partnership in it.
Amen. Bless you, my God. And thank you for the recognition. But all I do, I can't forget my first lady, Lady Tyra. Amen. Thank God. I have a life here that is not a hell race.
You got a hell race, you can't do nothing.
And miss. I guess it was always right there by my side. Amen. We just celebrated 35 years and marriage and get them up to speed. And I took out the floor for a week for just rest and relaxation. Amen. Amen. So praise God. Please keep her in your prayers. Amen. She couldn't make it this morning. Amen. But I thank praise God for this event. And like Pastor said, all those who on the committee, exceptional job. Thank you, praise God, for each and every one of you. Amen. Praise God. Let's prepare to dismiss. We are having refreshments immediately after the services. For those who can't do the steps, we have the refreshments upstairs, and we also have them downstairs. We have to sit up. But please stay around. Let's fellowship and mingle. Something we have not done in over 3 years because of the pandemic. Amen. Let's take a few minutes and just fellowship with one another and appreciate on one another and appreciate. Take the time out, appreciate on our pastors. Amen. Let us all stand to prepare to dismiss. Father God, we thank you right now for each and every person under the sound of my voice, Father God. Everyone who is still live streaming with us, Father God. Lord, we thank you, Father God, for the man of God and the word that he brought forth on this day, Father God. Such a pertinent word, Father God. Such a right now and rainbow word, Father God. Lord, we thank you, Father God, even for our pastors, Father God, that you cover them, Father God, that you protect them, Father God, that you keep each and every person under the sound of my voices. I plead the blood of Jesus over this congregation, over this city, over this nation, and this world, Father God. Lord, we thank you, Father God, even as we leave this place, but never your presence, Father God. Bless us, keep us, and strengthen us. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you, and amen.